be moving inside that magnetic field from side to side. And as it approaches one side or another, I get a strengthening and lessening of the strength of the field, and that shows up in my current. Number of things that can affect the shaft, things such as a bent shaft or unbalance will cause the rotor itself to move. Torque. If I have torsional impulses on the shaft, it causes the shaft to twist down through its length, and when the shaft twists, it flexes a little bit. Also, things like misalignment or mistension belts. Okay, those put a pressure on the end of the shaft, and then through a lever action through the bearings, it'll cause the shaft to flex and bend. And another one people don't often think about is as I pass an AC current through any lump of steel, it will heat up, induction heating. Well, the reason why I have so many layers of laminations is to reduce that induction heating. If I have smeared laminations on my rotor or something else where I've got the laminations shorted together, that can cause dynamic eccentricity as the hot spot grows on one side of the rotor. That will cause the laminations on that side to expand and will draw the shaft in that direction, causing it to bend slightly, and this will often show up as dynamic eccentricity. And I'm going to quiz you on this at the end. Just kidding. This is a representation of, you know, in its simplest form, what happens through amplitude modulation. In electrical signature analysis, it's very rare to see a peak at your fault points. Normally you see side bands of either line frequency or running speed. The side bands are a direct result of the fact that I am dealing with amplitude modulation. And this is just the law that proves that. Another point that I want to make is something you may have heard of before, and that's called pole pass frequency. I show that at the bottom of the screen. There are a number of ways of showing it. One includes knowing the number of poles in the machine and so on and so on and so on. All of them come out to the exact same number. The most common one, which is the one that we're using in the development of the ISO standard for electrical signature analysis, is twice line frequency. So that's calculated by taking your synchronous RPM minus your actual running RPM divided by the synchronous RPM times 2 times the line frequency. And that will give your pole pass frequency. The importance of the pole pass frequency is that it is used to identify when you have broken rotor bars. Something very important to consider when you're doing electrical signature analysis, in addition to everything else, you have electrical considerations, plain and simple. You want to make sure that you have the proper PPE, or personal protective equipment, especially now with arc flash issues being more prevalent within OSHA and the NFPA 70E. All of the electrical signature analysis vendors now make special plugs that can be attached to the outside of the machine that are UL rated, that that will allow you to, pardon the noise in the background, that will allow you to plug directly into your machine from the outside and collect data without having to open the cabinets at all. The equipment information you need for electrical signature analysis is at least the horsepower, at least the voltage, current, and RPM information from the nameplate. What is nice to have, which provides a very, very accurate result or measurement, is the rest of the nameplate and the number of rotor bars and stator slots. Number of rotor bars and stator slots allow you to positively identify the issues that you're looking for. bearing information is also very important, because just like vibration analysis, you can detect bearing degradation at a much later stage than with vibration, but you can detect it. Where you can get some of the rotor bar and stator slot information, most of the software vendors have a motor database built into them with rotor bars and stator slots for most machines. You can use that if you know the manufacturer of the machine, the model number, the RPM, horsepower, of course, the basics. You can go in there, and if you aren't quite sure, and if your diagnostic equipment allows or automatically will detect the number of rotor bars and stator slots, you can go in and confirm that by knowing the nameplate information, looking at the database, and seeing if that range is correct. Not all manufacturers will have, say, several models of an 1800 RPM, 25 horsepower machine that necessarily have the same number of rotor bars and stator slots. Another area where you can get the information is the free Department of Energy's MotorMaster Plus software. If you go into the catalog data, many of the manufacturers included, as you can see in the lower right-hand side, the number of rotor bars and the number of stator slots. Not all have, but Baldor, Reliance, and a number of others have done that. Now, common motor fault issues. Stator mechanical issues, what I have on this chart, center frequency means that's the peak that you normally do not see. This gives you the calculation. So for a stator mechanical issue, the running speed times the stator slots is that center frequency. You normally do not see that peak. I say normally because I've been finding that as a problem gets worse and worse, that peak does begin to show. So running speed times stator slots with line frequency sidebands is stator mechanical. Stator mechanical indicates either coils loose in the stator, or we just discovered, and I'm actually going to use this as one of the case studies, if you have extremely long end turns or improperly blocked end turns in your electric motor, you will actually watch those windings flex back and forth as the magnetic fields pass through them and they interact with the rotor through stator mechanical. That's normally not something you want to see, because what that means is you have a bending and flexing and potential mechanical problems with the insulation system at a later stage. Rotor indicators are often the running speed time rotor bars with line frequency sidebands. Static eccentricity will normally be running speed times rotor bars with line frequency and then twice line frequency sidebands of that issue. I'm going to drop down one to dynamic eccentricity. You'll normally see the same thing as static eccentricity, but running speed sidebands around those peaks. Mechanical unbalance. This is using the higher frequency data, running speed times rotor bars, with line frequency sidebands, and then twice line frequency sidebands, basically like a static eccentricity, sometimes with some running speed. I normally see this as two pairs. If I'm at 60 hertz, there'll be two pairs at 60 hertz, then there'll be a space of 240 hertz, then two pairs at 100, I'm sorry, two pairs at 120, and the next one is spaced out 240 hertz, and then two pairs at 120. But there's an easier way of looking at it. If I look at the actual running speed of the motor, there will be a peak at running speed in the low frequency data. That peak, if it begins to grow and come up in demodulated data, that will usually also indicate either severe misalignment or mechanical unbalance. I'm finding I spend more time looking at that than I do the higher frequency data. Stator electrical, in particular, indicating shorts. Now, these would be when the short has started to occur. In small machines, you can sometimes see this. The motor does not have much longer to live. So if you do see stator electrical problems, that means you have to deal with it really fast. That's running speed times stator slots. with line frequency sidebands, with running speed sidebands around those. Now, rotor bar issues have been the number one